verse 1 through verse 8 here begins the reading of God's holy word that we read from the New King James Version. The former account I made, O Theophilus, of all that Jesus began both to do and teach, until the day in which he was taken up, after he, through the Holy Spirit, had given commandments to the apostles, whom he had chosen, to whom he also presented himself alive after his suffering from many, by many infallible proofs, being seen by them during 40 days, and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God. And being assembled together with them, he commanded them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, You have heard from me, for John truly baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. Therefore, when they had come together, they asked him, saying, Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel? And he said to them, It is not for you to know times or seasons, which the Father has put in his own authority, but you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem, and in all Judea and Samaria, and to the end of the earth. Amen. Thank God for the reading of his word. You may be seated. And the title of this message is My Witnesses. My Witnesses. The date was June 10th, 2019. Judge Dutton, I wish he was here today, but he's not. Judge Dutton had invited me the day before, having heard my testimony, my story, and seeing the similarities that he shared with me, having lost his wife at the same time, the same age, close to him. A lot of things were just so similar. It was amazing that day was my anniversary during the time when we were out to breakfast. And his wife was buried on June 10th. And it was just so much going on. He told me some days that we had to go out and eat. I said, what about tomorrow? And I was still not back to work yet. So we went out and we had breakfast. And one of the things he said to me was, the world is watching. The world is watching you to see what you're going to do in light of this situation. Then I get home. I took note on my Bible app that the scripture for the day was Acts chapter 1, verse 8. Let me read it again. But you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem, and in all Judea and Samaria, and to the end of the earth. And immediately I perceived that the Lord was speaking to me. The Lord calls us to be witnesses in every area of our lives. Some places he takes us for the express purpose of being a witness for him in that situation. He takes us there simply because he wants a witness there, and he trusts us that we're going to be a witness for him in that place. Now, while Jesus spoke of geographical areas in which his disciples were called to be his witnesses, in verse 8 he said, Jerusalem, all Judea, Samaria, and to the end of the earth. I realize that each of the geographical locations he mentioned are analogous to various life circumstances in which each of us find ourselves from time to time. They are geographical locations, but each of them we can see there are sort of like an analogy to certain situations we find ourselves in. In other words, although most of us, if not all of us, have never been either to Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, or the end of the earth, Jesus is giving the same charge to us as he did to his first century disciples. We each have our Jerusalem, our Judea, our Samaria, and our end of the earth circumstances and experiences to which Jesus calls us to be his witnesses. The disciples' preoccupation and question posed to Jesus represents the same thing that each of us tends to be preoccupied with today, the uncertainty of the future. We seem to be so preoccupied with it. They asked Jesus in verse 6, Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel? In other words, I am uncertain about what the future holds. What is Rome going to do to us? What's going to happen to us? Now that we see that you have been risen from the dead, now we realize indeed you are the king who will sit on David's throne. So are you going to now restore the kingdom to Israel and take it away from Rome? In other words, I am uncertain again about what the future holds. Us likewise, we think the same. What's going to happen to us in the future? What's going to happen to my children, my job, the economy, our nation, and so on? What's going to happen? The future is uncertain. Lord, what are you going to do about what's coming down the pipeline? What's going to happen with the stock market? What's going to happen with my portfolio? But note Jesus' response. He said in verse 7, it is not for you to know times or seasons which the Father has put in his own authority. God has the future in his own authority. Don't you worry about that. In essence, you are concerned, and he went on to say, after that he said, but the conjunction comes up, but you shall receive power. When the Holy Spirit comes on you, you shall be witnesses to me. So in essence, your concern should not be about what the future holds, which includes your circumstances and your experiences, or where you will find yourself geographically. But what you should be concerned about is that you should be concerned to see to it that you are my witnesses. No matter what your experience, no matter where life takes you, no matter where you find yourself geographically, no matter how the plane might change, no matter what happens to the stock market, the portfolio, your job, your health, your family, just be concerned to be my witnesses. Again, the four geographical locations that Jesus mentioned are analogous to circumstances and experiences in which we find ourselves from time to time. Indeed, we are often placed there by God Himself for the express purpose of being His witnesses. You've got to get this down in your spirit, because when things happen to you, people are going to point the finger and say, yes, He did something. Yes, He did something. But God is the one who has you there to be a witness for Him. Is not. There's a difference between what people believe versus what you know. What you know is what, and don't know is what's going to determine your attitude. My people are destroyed not because of what people believe, but because of a lack of knowledge. You have to know for yourself. So God Himself places us in certain situations for the express purpose of us being His witnesses. Because the Lord needs a witness in every, in each of the four corners of the earth. Each of the four. He needs a witness there. So no matter what our circumstances, no matter what life presents, no matter where we find ourselves geographically, just see to it that we are witnesses for Christ. So in these four geographical locations, they represent some of the circumstances that we find ourselves in from time to time in life. So yes, we were there. Back in the first century, Jesus charged these, when it was 120 up in the upper room, so it might have been 120 at that point when he said, saying this. We weren't there to hear it, but it's just as if we're there, because those four areas that he said to go to, we see ourselves there likewise. So we're going to look at that. We look first of all, he said, go to Jerusalem. I stay in Jerusalem. They were in Jerusalem. He told them not to leave Jerusalem. And I realize that Jerusalem is sort of like the area of comfort. So Jesus says, stay in Jerusalem and wait for the promise that you have heard will come. Stay in Jerusalem. So Jerusalem represents the place of comfort, a comfort zone. And it's not necessarily a bad thing. Now, when we hear about a comfort zone, we think it's something bad. But notice that Jesus Himself told him to be there. He said in verse 4, and be assembled together with them. He commanded them not to depart from Jerusalem. Or he said not to depart from the comfort zone. There's a time and a place for everything. It's like the eagle with this young one in the nest. He goes and get out of the nest, get out of this comfort zone. Well, you've got to be there for a while. So he said, stay right here until you receive the promise which you have heard from me because John baptized with the water and all these things. He said, you can stay here for a while until I say otherwise. But for now, stay in the comfort zone. What made Jerusalem the comfort zone? It was the epicenter of worship. It was where the temple was. It was the familiar. It was where one would expect to be accepted. It's like you come into church, it's like a comfort zone. So when you shout hallelujah, you don't expect anybody to look at you funny because you're in the comfort zone. But when you're on your job and you say hallelujah, they say call the boss. Let's light him up because this, you know, he's trying to be there. He's a Christian environment versus a Muslim or some other thing. But when you're in your comfort zone, you're in the place where you know you're going to be accepted, where things are familiar, and it's what, you know, the protocol calls for. So Jerusalem represents that. Still, there are challenges to the call to be witness, even in the comfort zone. So Jesus said, be my witness in Jerusalem. Even though it's a place where worship should be expected, even though sometimes we don't want to be witnesses for Christ. For one, it's too, once for one, one is too at ease at times. And are drawn into the pleasures of the place so that we are not thinking about witnessing. Witnessing is not a priority because all is just so much at ease. We're just at ease. The comfort zone is like our home. It's like our circle of friends. It's like our home church, our community, and so on. You know, it is easy to be caught up in the routines of family life, of friendships, of community life. And in the process, we fail to realize what we are called to be and to do because we are so comfortable where we are. How many of us fail to witness to our family members, our friends, our neighbors? We're in the comfort zone and we're so comfortable. We're not telling our spouses about Jesus. We're not telling our children about Jesus. Our loved ones, our friends in our circle, we're not telling them about Jesus. We're not witnessing to them like we're called to do. The comfort zone has its challenges as well. For Jerusalem was often a hostile environment. It was there that Peter and John said, look at us to the lame man. He said, silver and gold have I none, but such as I have given to you in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Rise, take up your bed and walk. And the man took up his bed and walked. And what happened? They were dragged before the Sanhedrin. They were put on trial for doing a good deed. So Jerusalem wasn't always so welcoming of the witness of Christ. And so it is with the comfort zone. We don't have always a listening ear about our family members and friends. They don't always want to hear about Jesus. They don't always want to see the good things that the Lord has done. So even Jesus said in Matthew 10, verse 36, a man's foes will be those of his own household. So sometimes our enemies, our biggest enemies, are right on the same roof with us. So our comfort zone may not be a place that's very receptive of the witness of Christ. Nevertheless, Jesus said we should be witnesses to him in Jerusalem. Or we can substitute that and say in the comfort zone. Be witnesses by our conduct and by our conversation. How many of us come into the house of God lifting up what looks like holy hands without laughing and doubting? But our spouses know that those hands are filled with blood. They are evil. And they know that what comes about out of our mouth is filth. The closer we come into the house of God looking like we're so sanctified and deep. But the ones under our roofs know the real deal because under our roofs is a comfort zone and we have not been a witness there by our conduct and by our conversation. But Jesus is saying, you shall be my witnesses even in Jerusalem. Yes, the word of God is prevalent in Jerusalem, but I'm calling you to be my witness in unique ways that no one else can be a witness. And in our homes, the word of God may be heard by someone else, but our spouses need to see that we are living and walking epistles. Our children need to see it in us. They need to see it from us. Don't worry about the pastor and the Sunday school teacher. They're looking at you. Jesus is saying, be my witness even in the comfort zone. People in our neighborhood, that's another area of the comfort zone, our neighborhood, where we live, where we reside. We're not witnesses to them sometimes because they know what goes down when we throw that barbecue in the summer. They know what we do. They see the smoke. And it's not the barbecue smoke. They even smell it. They don't smell like barbecues, you know, smoke. I remember one time I came to my neighborhood to my surprise and stuff. I smell it. I'm like, I call the police. This is not barbecue smoke I'm smelling. So some of us, we're not witnesses to Christ, even in our neighborhood where we are to be active and concerned. And our neighbors know it. They like to see us going off to church, but they also know what we do Monday through Saturday and Sunday afternoon, by the way. Because we're not witnesses for the Lord at Jerusalem in the comfort zone. But he said, you shall be my witnesses in Jerusalem. Then he moved on from there and he said, not just in Judea, but in all Judea. Judea represents the circumference. Judea, the circumference. He said, all of Judea, the entire region. Think of a circle. The circumference is that line that you see going all the way around and it's unbroken. That's the outer limits. We are the center point and we have the outer regions. And we understand here, Jesus is saying, you shall be my witnesses in Jerusalem. But you know what? After a while, it's time to spread out. If you read Acts chapter 1, verse 1, it says, now Saul, who later became Paul, was consenting to his death, talking about the death of Stephen. And at that time, a great persecution arose against the church, which was at where? The comfort zone, Jerusalem. And they were what? Scattered throughout the regions of Judea and Samaria, except the apostles. So we see that it was time to spread out. And we look at Galatians chapter 1, when the apostle Paul, some years later, had gone to Jerusalem. In verse 22, he said, afterward, I went into the regions of Syria and Cilicia, and I was unknown by the faces, to the churches of Judea, which were in Christ. So Paul got to Judea, and there were already many churches there. So the word of God was spreading out, moving out from Jerusalem. They were spreading to the circumference, the surrounding areas, not just Judea, but all of Judea. The province of Judea was the southernmost part of the Roman territory, and it included Judea, included Jerusalem, Bethlehem, Jericho, and some other areas. So though this region of Judea was not the epicenter of worship, each was very much connected. Many areas such as Bethlehem and Jericho, they were still connected to the epicenter, which was Jerusalem. This is why there were synagogues throughout the region. It was a little too far for them to keep walking to the temple, so they had the synagogues to stay connected. So this is like the circle again. Even though you're not at the center point, the circumference is still very much a part of the circle itself. People travel from every region to Jerusalem from time to time for the feast. So as it is with the circle, while all Judea was not the center of worship, all was a part of the circle nonetheless. Thus all surrounding parts of the circle remain connected. All Judea does represent that which is connected but distant. So when Jesus said, go to all Judea, he said, go to that which is connected but still distant. Distant from that center point in Jerusalem. It's like our schools in the neighborhood, our jobs, people who meet in the community. They're connected geographically, but they're not connected by the blood of Christ. They're connected in the sense that they're close by, they can see the church, they can look across the street and see the church, but they're not connected, they're not in the church. Jesus is saying, don't just go to church, don't just go to Jerusalem, get out into the surrounding region, into all Judea, don't leave any part left out. Go to all the regions, you gotta be my witnesses there. They're in the area, but they're unaware of who I am, says the Lord. You have to go and tell them, you have to be my witnesses. They're connected geographically, but they have not yet been connected by my blood. The Lord needs a witness here. Often we wonder, what am I doing in this school? What am I doing on this job, in this neighborhood, this community, in this place in life? What am I doing here? What am I called to this? What is going on? Could it be that the Lord simply wants us here to be a witness? Even for a season, this could be our Judea. God has us on that job because this is our Judea. He wants us, yes, we are still in Conyers, but he wants us to go to all the region of Agape County. I want you in that school over there. I want you to move to that neighborhood over there. I want you to make sure that all of Judea knows about me. So if you don't know, just look at things the way they are. I'm just on this job to get a paycheck. I'm in the school to acquire an education. No. God has you there because he needs a witness there. Why do we think about it that way sometimes? It will cause us to see things differently sometimes. When we get the hardship and the job, we say, Lord, I'm here as a witness for you. You think everything's going to go easy? He never promised us a flowery bed of ease. But he promised us, and he said, those who live godly in Christ Jesus, you are going to suffer some persecution. So it might take some persecution in that job, in that school, but I need you there to be a witness for me. Somebody needs to take this to heart. You in a job, you in a school, you in a neighborhood, you in a situation, you're wondering what is going on. God may just have you there for a season, for a good reason, to be a witness for him. That is your Judea experience. He wants you to be a witness for him. America as a whole is like Judea. It's in close proximity to the temple. Yet it is as great a mission field as anywhere else on planet Earth. Let me say that again. America as a whole is like Judea. It is in close proximity to the temple. Yet it is as great a mission field as anywhere else in the world. A lot of us would buy plane tickets and travel all over the place. And right next door is some heathen. Heathen that we did not tell. That's a heathen, by the way. We did not even tell him about Jesus. What are we going all over the place? America is a mission field. It's on the same level as, because it's worse than some places that the places that never heard of Jesus are in better shape standing before God than America sometimes. To whom much is given what? Much more is required of him. If you got all this word, and you ain't living right, the person who ain't got no word, God judged them on the basis, according to Romans 2, on the basis of their conscience. Without the word, God still can judge them, but not on the same basis as he judges us. We got so much word, and we don't want to live right. The one who's in the jungle, who don't have any word, they might stand a better chance than us in judgment. And that's what America is like. America is like Judea. Close proximity to the temple, but far from it. We did the same, near to the church, but what? Far from God. That's how a lot of America is. So that's our Judea experience when we find ourselves in jobs, in schools, in communities where we don't really want to be. Because God is saying, this is Judea, and you're there. We're in Judea, but are we witnessing to the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ? We think we're in a job simply to get a paycheck, a school simply to acquire an education, in the neighborhood simply because we needed a place of residence, in the community because it was in a good school district. But we fail to realize that we are called to be witnesses to the risen Lord in Judea. The church is Jerusalem, so to speak, but they won't come in here. So we are called to witness to them where they are, in all Judea. You shall be my witnesses in all Judea. And then he moved on to say, you shall be my witnesses also in Samaria. Samaria represents the area of conflict. Samaria, the area of conflict. The origin of the Samaritans go back to 722 B.C. When the 727 B.C. Shalmaneser V went in and conquered Samaria. And then 5 years later, Sargon II came in and he bragged about taking away 27,290 down to the exact 27,290 captives to Assyria. And then he brought in Assyrians into the land. And eventually they intermarried and mixed up and everything happened. And before you know, they had a mixed breed. So the Samaritans were a mixed breed. And we see that in Ezra chapter 4, when Ezra is doing the genealogies and all these things are happening, there were contentions building up because the Samaritans were complaining, all these things are going on. And in John chapter 4, when Jesus sat at the well and met the woman from Samaria, he spoke to her, and the woman was amazed because she said, "What are you doing talking to me?" Because verse 9 of chapter 4 said, "The Jews have no dealings with Samaritans. You're not even supposed to talk to me." We have conflict between each other. But by conflict here, I'm not necessarily talking about contention, but differences of beliefs. This is epitomized by Jesus' encounter with the woman at the well, the Samaritan woman. There was conflict of belief concerning the place of worship. She said, "The Samaritan said we should worship in this mountain, but you said you should worship in Jerusalem." Then you come to conflict about the well. "Well, are you greater than our father Jacob who built this well?" And all these things are going on. So we have conflict of beliefs concerning the person of Jesus Christ. Figuratively, Samaria is an interesting place. Note, the Jews were blood relatives of Samaritans. Because in John chapter 4, verse 12, the Samaritan woman said to Jesus, "Are you greater than our father Jacob?" In Jacob, the father of the 12 tribes, and she said, "You're great. You're our father too. Who do you think you are? You think you're greater than him? That's my father you're talking about here." So they were blood relatives, but there was so much at odds with each other you would never know it. Likewise, Samaria represents our marriages, our homes, the ones close to us, but there's so much conflict you wouldn't even know. You can put a microphone in some cars, but I can tell you we have a rough time listening to that stuff when you're driving up the show. All the fighting that goes on between husband and wife and children, and you come inside, but the fighting, you wouldn't know it. Samaria is going on in there, conflict. How many of those who are close to us, but we're in conflict with them over beliefs, where the Christ of God is concerned? By his actions and stories, Jesus foretold that such conflict should not be a hindrance to our witness in Samaria, however. There will be conflict, but that should not hinder you from being my witness. You should, Samaria represents a place of conflict, but you should be my witness there. Recall the parable of the Good Samaritan and the woman at the well. In both instances, we see something operative. When the man was beaten up coming from Jericho, a priest passed on the other side, a Levite passed, and a Samaritan came, bound up his wounds, put him on his donkey, took him to the gatekeeper, and gave him some money to the man, and said, "Take care of it. If you need any more money, I'll come back and pay it to you." That's a true neighbor. That is one who loves. Jesus likewise is speaking to a woman who surely should have nothing to do with. The woman came out in the middle of the day, in the heat of the day, to get water because she wanted to avoid the Jews. And here the Jews sitting down talking to her. Why? Because he loved her. So Jesus is saying, the way you be my witness in the midst of conflict is by loving. You get to love. That's how they're going to know that you are my disciples. John 13:35, by this, we all know that you are my disciples. If you have love one for another, you see, in conflict, you can't worry about arguing because everybody got a good point. That's the thing, you know, the scholars on that side, the scholars on this side, and everybody got a good point. But when you love somebody, God said they will take notice of that. The love of God will just shed blood in my heart. It will draw them in, but I'm not arguing. Push them away. Don't try to resolve the conflict by arguing and showing how much you know, but simply love. That's the way you resolve it. So even in our marriages, in our homes, in our communities, where conflict is, the way we're going to get around it is we're going to have to love. Somebody's going to have to take up the mantle and say, "I'm going to love. I choose to love. I'm not going to argue with you. As a matter of fact, I'm going to turn the other cheek. You want my coat? Take my cloak. You want my gift? Take my back. I'm going to turn the other cheek and choose to love." That's how it's going to be resolved in this situation. Jesus is saying, by love, we're going to be able to witness in the midst of conflict. That's the only way. So even in Samaria where there's conflict, we are called to be Christ's witnesses. Love is the key. close the door so we can enter and make Christ known. You are in a contention with a Muslim. He's going to come with all his Muslim scriptures and Muslim this and that. You come with your Bible stuff and Bible that. And for months you're going out into the safety and getting nowhere. That's not going to do it. Love will. The scholarly arguments won't do it. There's flaws on both sides. You shall be my witnesses in Samaria where there's conflict. And the way you're going to do it is through love. You might need to take this to heart. Because two people butting heads ain't going to work. Somebody got to decide, I'm going to be the one. I'll suffer the most. I'll suffer the shame. I'm going to suffer the blame. I'll take it for the sake of love. And watch what will happen. Because when you stand up for love, God will stand up for you. I said, God will stand up for you. God will fight the battle because you have done it God's way. Hallelujah. In the midst of your marriage or situation, that's the problem. Nobody's loving anymore. You know, there's stuff about, I have to change up the way I do marriages and weddings. You're coming here with all this laughing and smiling. That's not going to cut it. We got to talk about what you're going to do when somebody don't agree with you. One thing I don't like with the line, I'm still being like that at the altar. That's not going to get you by. You're just thinking about a wedding and not a marriage. There's a difference between a wedding that's a ceremony and marriage is for a lifetime. That's the problem today. We're not preparing for a lifetime. We're preparing for our wedding day. When you prepare for a lifetime, you are determined to love. That's what will resolve the conflicts that we're facing today. I'm amazed how so many couples have all this problem. And you're like, but how could this be? Weren't you the one grinning and smiling and clean and all this stuff at the altar? What happened to that? Oh, circumstances and, maybe I can start with the difference. They don't come out with the big words. You just don't love each other. I got a four-letter word. L-O-V-E versus that long word is irreconcilable. And you can't even spell. Don't come with that. You just don't love each other. You need to get back to basics and start loving again. And if both of you don't want to do it, one of you should be able to do it. And that one will win over the other because it won't be just one will be you with God on your side. Hallelujah. And that's the formula for success. In every conflict, in every conflict. That's what Jesus did. He simply loved. So you shall be my witnesses in Samaria, even in the place of conflict. Finally, Jesus said, you shall be my witnesses to the end of the earth. And the end of the earth represents the area of catastrophe. The area of catastrophe. The disciples were called to go to the end of the earth to preach the gospel. The book of Acts simply scratches the surface. It only scratched the surface. The writer, Luke, who wrote the gospel of Luke and Acts, clearly a two-volume work. That's why he said the former word that I read was Theophilus. The first one was the Theophilus as well, which means the love of God. So, the book of Acts scratches the surface of me. The writer Luke traveled with Paul. So, what we see is much of Paul's story. And we think the whole book of Acts is mostly about Paul. Well, the last half is mostly about Paul. But doesn't mean the book says the Acts of the Apostles. And we see the last 16 chapter about one apostle. It doesn't mean the other apostles went on vacation. It just means that Luke was traveling with him and he wrote what he experienced with him. The first 12 chapters were primarily about Peter, and 13 to 28 is primarily about Paul. If you see in Mark chapter 16, verse 20, the Bible said that they went everywhere and preached the gospel after Jesus ascended. And in Galatians chapter 1, verses 18 to 19, Paul said, then after 3 days I went up to Jerusalem to see Peter, and remained with him 15 days. That's a long time. He didn't have a lot of stuff to do. Think about it. No TV to watch, no Facebook. For 15 days, you're going to do a lot of talking. It's different. That's a long time. 15 minutes. Nowadays, this gives up order. So imagine 15 days. He said, people have to say, but I saw none of the other apostles. You might ask yourself, why? I saw none of the other apostles except James, if he wasn't an apostle. The brother of our Lord. James is the brother, he was the brother of the 12. James, the brother of our Lord. And he said, that's somebody. So the point I'm trying to make is, these guys were gone, not on vacation. After what Jesus had gone through, his passion and his directive to them to go through, you think they were traveling to the gospel chapel, roll and go sit on a beach somewhere? No, they were preaching the gospel everywhere. So the book of Acts only scratches the surface. We don't know what these other guys did by and large. Tradition also had apostles in foreign countries. It believed that Thomas went as far as India. That's a long journey on a boat. Matthew to Ethiopia. We don't know all where they went, but God knows. We just know they went everywhere preaching the gospel. They went, as Jesus said, to the end of the earth. It was concealed in this area, the end of the earth. But the Lord ministered to me. I started out by saying the Lord ministered to me. I'm finally coming to what he ministered to me. Because this message is not just for me, it's for all of us. He ministered to me, beginning with the charge that Judge Barton gave to me and the scripture of Acts chapter 1, verse 8. He said, the world is watching. And in Acts chapter 1, verse 8 said, you shall be my witnesses in all these areas, Jerusalem, Judea, all Judea and Samaria, and to the end of the earth. The end of the earth may be summed up into one word, foreign. Foreign. Like a foreigner. What do we know about foreign places? They are of a different tongue, even in the same language. I won't speak in English, but I promise you, I can say something that you have no idea what I'm saying. And it will be English. Same language, but a different tongue. We have colloquialism. We have different accents. You know what? As a matter of fact, there are some people that talk to me right here in the South, and I don't know what they're saying. And they speak in English. So, you can be in the same language, but a different tongue. Because you're foreign. And foreign has now shrunk. Foreign just means south versus north. It used to be another country. So we have colloquialism, we have Papua, and we speak in the Caribbean in a way that, if you don't understand it, you're not going to understand it. Foreign also means different cultures. It means different customs, foods, etc. It simply means a different world. Jesus said you ought to go to these places. Though we may not leave the U.S. of A or the South, figuratively there comes a time when we're called to go to the end of the earth to be a witness for Christ. Let me say it again. Though you may not have ever or will never leave the U.S. of A or even the South, there comes a time still that we are all called to go to the end of the earth by the experiences and circumstances we find ourselves in, simply to be a witness for Christ. That's when we experience that which is foreign to us, no matter the end of the earth can be something in one word, foreign. So we experience things that are foreign to us. When you experience something that is foreign to you, think of end of the earth. This is an end of the earth experience because it's totally foreign to me. It's not what I'm accustomed to in Jerusalem, nor in all Judea, not even in Samaria. This is an end of the earth experience. This is foreign to me. Such as losing the one closest to you. Let me stand back. Both hands and feet. That's what that was. I got a way to lose the one closest to you. That's foreign to me. That's an end of the earth experience. I told you the Lord was speaking to me. And I raised both hands and feet. I'm not going to do it again. I'm going to do it too tired. I put a little bit of my to yourself. Losing the one closest to you. Losing your job when you were already behind. You ever heard the same, I was so far behind, I thought I was ahead. You ever watched the Olympics and they had those real long races? And the really, really good guys from 10 years, would be ahead of them. But somebody's ahead of them, and the reason is because they lack the last person. So that guy looked like he's ahead, but he lacked behind. And you don't keep track of the race, you think he's in front. So sometimes we're so far behind financially that we think we are ahead. Meanwhile, we're way behind in the midst of all that we lose our jobs. Catastrophe. End of the earth experience. Falling ill, gravely ill. End of the earth, because that's something you're accustomed to. Feeling like your world is crumbling around you, your marriage is under the rocks, your children disrespect you, and instead of rising up and calling you blessed, the only thing left for them to you, to do to you, which they have not done yet, is to curse you out. It's an end of the earth experience. Sometimes God just sends us when we get the street. Sometimes God Himself assigns us to the end of the earth. All the time we just find ourselves there, but either way, we are there. Sometimes God has us to be there. Sometimes we find ourselves there, but either way, listen, how am I not here? I mean, like I said, did you come from the boat last night? Well, there's a boat or a plane. I am here. Who cares how? We're just focusing on where we are right now. Where is the boat to play in your car? A submarine, you are here. So sometimes God Himself is the one that has where you're fighting against the devil and God. So what are you doing? You ever heard the fact that the devil sometimes is crying? They say, what are you crying about? They're blaming me for everything. I didn't do everything. Sometimes it is God. Stuff. Sometimes God Himself takes us to the end of the earth. Why? Because He needs a witness there. The world is watching and taking note of our conduct and our conversation, whether we bear witness to the Lordship of Christ, even during the catastrophic moments in our lives, which takes place at the end of the earth. And that's especially when they're going to be watching you. And just that, and told me the world is watching. Look at what happened to the Apostle Paul on the island of Malta. He's the one himself, but out of the fire came a viper and grabbed onto his head. And you think those natives who said, let's grab that thing, let's suck the blood out, they just watched him. The Bible said they watched him because they said, surely this man did something wrong. He escaped the seas because of the shipwreck, but now fate got him and fight the victim. And they watched him, and they watched him, and they watched him. And he shook it off in the fire, and they kept watching him. And they said, surely this man is going to kill him, but because you know what? These guys knew the caliber of fight that they were looking at. You see, for us, we see a snake, but we think snake. But all snakes are not bad. And as a matter of fact, they will charge you $1,000 if you kill a king snake in Georgia. I was told. Don't quote me on that, but that's what I was told. They said if you kill a bat, you're not supposed to kill those things because they are good for the ecosystem. But we think it's snake. And the fighters, the natives of Malta were not there. When they saw that snake, they understood the kind of snake it was. And when it bit Paul, they expected him to die. And that's what the world is doing when catastrophe hit. They're not trying to come and help you. All you stuff about, I'm praying for you. Give me a break. Let me say it again. Give me a break. Half of the people who say they're praying when the virus and all help you came in. So they did pray, but that's not the kind of prayer I'm looking for. I need a real prayer. Somebody just texted me recently from New York telling me about my sister's pastor. I need some serious prayer. That's what we got to put adjectives. Don't just say pray for me. Pray seriously for me. Pray fervently. You know the Bible said it. Effectual fervent prayer. Two adjectives. Not just the prayer, but the effectual fervent prayer. What they're doing more than anything is watching you to see your people run die. The world is watching you when you go to the end of the earth and experience the catastrophes that await you there. But I want you to know that God Himself sometimes assigns us there. But it's hard to be a witness at a time like that. True, But you're forgetting something. Jesus prophesied Paul to go to the end of the earth and to Jerusalem, Jerusalem, by saying, you shall receive power. He didn't just say, go, and oh, by the way, you shall receive power. He doesn't need to tell you something. You gotta say something up front. You gotta say the encouraging word up front, because these guys were already scared. They were scared because they saw their master crucified, and yes, he raised from the dead, but now you tell me you're going to heaven. So what are we supposed to do out here? So he did not say, you gotta go here and do this and do that, and then yeah, you go, by the way, I'm gonna give you some power. No, he said up front, you shall receive power. So you're saying it's hard for me to witness in this place. Yes, it is, but you're forgetting something. You shall receive power, says the Lord. Dynamite power. That's what we got the word dynamite from. This is an explosion that's about to happen. Hallelujah. That's the kind of power that awaits you when you choose to obey me and stand up as a witness for me. Even in the midst of your tragedy, says the Lord. How do you think I'm standing up here right now? I said, how do you think I'm standing up here? Because of the Holy Ghost on the inside, giving me the power to be God's witness. In a time like this, hallelujah, I'm not waiting to you. Is there anyone else? Is there anyone else who's going through an unbearable experience, but you're still standing? You're still standing because of the Holy Ghost on the inside, giving you the power to witness nonetheless. Yes, I'm in the midst of the storm, but even in the midst of the storm, I can be a witness for Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. That's the way I'm able to stand, and that's the way you are able to stand. Hallelujah. I can't stand without taking one pill. I haven't taken a pill yet. And I promise you, by the grace of God, I'm not taking any. Not because I'm being defiant, not because I'm being stubborn, but because I don't need it. I have the Holy Ghost on the inside, giving me the power to be a witness of Christ. Even at the end of the earth experience that I'm going through right now. And I want you to know, this is beyond hard. It's beyond difficult. It's beyond what I can express in words. It feels worse now than when it first happened. And that is the gospel truth. But God has given me this strength. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Hallelujah. Who strengthens me. All things through Christ. Hallelujah. His grace is sufficient. I said His grace is sufficient. Hallelujah. His grace is more than enough. Hallelujah. It gives us strength. Hallelujah. I don't know what you're going through. I don't know if you're there yet. But we each have our end of the earth experience to go through. Because God wants us to be a witness there. You see, when God comes to the end of the earth, when He sent those guys to the end of the earth, He said we need to go over there to witness the trees and rocks. No, it's because there are people over there. There are other people who are going through what you're going through. You are not the first one. You are not the only one. And you won't be the last one. I need you to be a witness for me because there are souls over there too. And there are souls in Jerusalem and in Judea and in Samaria. But to the end of the earth, there are souls all around. And I want you to be my witness. And the only way you can be my witness is by going there. Well, this is not geographical. You may never ever get on a plane or a boat to go anywhere. But your experiences and circumstances will measure up just the same to the end of the earth experience. Where there are souls there that are hurting, they need to know that Jesus loves them. When they see what you're going through and that Jesus loves you, God is still using you. They can be encouraged, they can be strengthened. Hallelujah. To fight the good fight. To come to know Jesus. On my job, one of my jobs in New York, there was a girl there, one woman, who always used to say, can I get a witness? And Jesus, the Lord of glory, likewise said, can I get a witness? Can I get a witness in Jerusalem? can I get a witness in all of Judea? Can I get a witness in Samaria? And can I get a witness in the end of the earth, to the end of the earth? Hallelujah. Why would the end of the earth something also important to remember? Is that Jesus, in his final words in the Great Commission in Matthew, says, no, he said, go into the whole of the world and preach the gospel, make disciples of every creature, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. And lo, I'm with you. Always, even unto the end of the age. The end of the age is even deeper than the end of the world. The end of the world, and you're thinking about planet Earth, but Jesus is talking about the end of time. I'm going to be with you. So no matter where you are, just know that Jesus promised, hallelujah, that he will be with us. Christ wants us to be a witness for him. There are people who have lost loved ones likewise, lost their jobs, lost their peace, lost their hope, lost their relationships, such as with their spouse and their children. People who are likewise written, you shall be my witnesses even to the end of the earth.